Thank you, Norman, and it's an honor to speak after these speakers. I won't have time to list all of the reasons I want U.S. military planes and drones out of Syrian skies, much less all the reasons people have noted in the comments on our petition, which you can read at rootsaction.org, but there is no question what my first reason is, although it is not a reason always given much weight here in Washington, D.C. These planes kill a lot of people. People all of equal value, regardless of their religion or ethnicity. The U.S. military's casualty figures have such a record of error that I would trust them about as far as I could throw a Pentagon contract. Air Wars identifies thousands of civilian deaths from U.S. and allied planes, 4,734 to 7,337 in Syria and Iraq. And such counts generally turn out to be many times under the counts that comprehensive post-war studies arrive at. On top of which, we have the problem of all the people killed who are not counted by virtue of not being labeled civilian. Always an empirically and morally iffy labeling process. Then there are the injuries that almost always outnumber the deaths, the homelessness, the extremely long-term effects of the U.S. use of depleted uranium by some of the planes we want out of those skies, the starvation that could have been prevented for a fraction of the cost of the planes, and of course, the top killer of U.S. troops, suicide. The primary reason that what would otherwise be considered mass murder is given little heed is that it is understood to serve some higher purpose in both moral and legal senses. But what purpose is served by U.S. planes over Syria? If longer than most major wars of the past isn't long enough to figure that out, how about a purpose served by bombing Afghanistan, or Iraq, or Pakistan, or Libya, or Yemen? Apart from selling weapons and creating more enemies for the next war, what has been accomplished? Former CIA bin Laden unit chief Michael Schur says the more the U.S. fights terrorism, the more it creates terrorism. The CIA's own July 7, 2009 report called Best Practices in Counterinsurgency says drone killing is counterproductive. Admiral Dennis Blair, former director of National Intelligence, says the same. General James E. Cartwright, former vice chair of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, says drone strikes could be undermining long-term efforts. Quote, "We're seeing that blowback. If you're trying to kill your way to a solution, no matter how precise you are, you're going to upset people even if they're not targeted," end quote. That is true whether or not the plane has a pilot in it. Maintaining the momentum of permanent war is obviously not a high moral purpose. Jody Rudoran in the New York Times on September 6th this past year reported that, quote, "For Jerusalem, the status quo, horrific as it may be from a humanitarian perspective, seems preferable to either a victory for Mr. Assad's government and his Iranian backers or a strengthening of rebel groups increasingly dominated by Sunni jihadists. This is a playoff situation in which you need both teams to lose, but at least you don't want one to win. We'll settle for a tie," said Alan Pincus, a former Israeli consul general in New York. Quote, "Let them both bleed. Hemorrhage to death. That's the strategic thinking here," end quote. This endless war for war's sake may be done in the name of democracy, and you may be able to get television viewers to cheer momentarily for missiles launched from a ship, which has almost the same problems as those launched from the air. But people in the very same polls that cheer for those missiles say the U.S. should get out of this war. Public pressure was key to preventing the start of a U.S. war, air war, in Syria in 2013. Never has the public or the Congress advocated for or authorized this war. It is a war destructive of the rule of law. Nowhere does the UN Charter or the Kellogg-Briand Pact permit this action from air, ground, or water. Special Operations Command Chief Army General Raymond Thomas 2 weeks ago admitted this was illegal, claiming to defend U.S. troops in Syria against aggression by Syria is not a legal argument for defensiveness, but a declaration of lawless imperialism. And of course, stuff Harold Coe makes up isn't actually law. President Obama's decision to arm and train proxies was against the law, dramatically against public opinion and against the report he had commissioned from the CIA on whether such efforts had ever succeeded in the past. President Trump's announcement that he will cease those efforts and henceforth fight on only one side of this war is a nod to reality, law, and possibly decency, given the account of his decision having followed his viewing of a video of CIA-backed fighters killing a child. But this war continues to kill children. This is all before mentioning the risk of apocalyptic nuclear confrontation with Russia as a result of Russia also fighting an immoral, illegal, and counterproductive war in Syria. That alone, as Norman described, is reason to remove every U.S. plane or drone. This is also without considering the environmental damage done to Syria and to our atmosphere. You can drive your car all year, feel guilty about it, but you won't pollute the sky like one flight of one of these planes. And then there's the financial cost. National Priorities Project puts the cost of the war on ISIS at $16 billion and counting, more than the UN says would be needed annually to have clean drinking water everywhere on Earth, and more than half what the UN says it would take to end hunger not just in Syria, but globally. And this war serves as the top public justification for military spending that adds up to about $1 trillion a year in the United States. That choice of how to spend our resources kills more people than all current wars put together because of where that money is not spent. A fraction of that spending could be invested in diplomacy, aid, disarmament, and unarmed peacekeeping to far better effect. These alternatives have been available since day one and still are. The United States spent years sabotaging UN attempts at peace in Syria. According to former Finnish president and Nobel Peace Prize laureate Martti Ahtisaari, the United States dismissed out of hand a Russian peace proposal for Syria in 2012. The U.S. ruined last year's ceasefire by firing on Syrian troops. Nothing is going to quickly bring peace and prosperity to Syria, but continuing to do what we know makes matters worse has to end. We have to give peace a chance. Thank you.